Thank you for your patience. So we are discussing the Damodarashtakam. And the fifth verse of the Damodarashtakam is the So Krishna acts in a way, say performing mischief, by which devotees feel needed. Yashoda mai feels needed. And the fourth verse is describing how such a wonderful conception of divinity, that God, rather than residing in cosmic majesty, delights in the reciprocation of love. And therefore, there is much, it's much more relishable. So if you have a camera, sometimes we are, maybe if you're looking around the binoculars, we're looking at the sky, looking at the distance, and we see something interesting, and then we focus on it. So the fourth verse is saying that I just want to meditate on the Lord. And the fifth verse says, it describes further the Lord and His beauty. Idamte mukhambojam atyanta neelai. So we will do one thing. We will just recite one line together. And then discuss the meaning. Okay. You have a display of that. So, mostly first, if you know it, we'll just sing it together. Fifth verse, first line. First and second lines together. Idam te mukham bhojam atyanta neelai Vritam kuntalai snigdha raksha gopyam. Okay, yeah, we'll come to that. So, idam te mukham bhojam. This form of Krishna. Okay, it's not working. No. Okay, fine. Idam te mukhambojam atyanta neelair. He's describing this beautiful form. It's like a lotus. So he's, Pratyavatmuni, the composer of this song, he's so captivated. I just want to meditate on him. Now you might say that if somebody, the previous verse also, he said, I want to meditate constantly on this. I don't want anything else. So what's so interesting about it? So he's describing what is so interesting. So idam te mukhambojam atyanta neelai. It's exquisitely beautiful. It's exquisitely beautiful and is bluish in color. Vritam kuntalai snigdha raktaischa gopya. So his face is bluish black in complexion, and then there are this blackish hair, their curly silken hair, and they are encircling his head, and as he's beholding it, see, this is so attractive. This is what I want to behold constantly. I don't want anything else. Then Rutam Kuntalai Snigdha Raktaischa Gopya. So now there is something more, and this is the very significant part of this verse, and that's what we will focus on. So let's recite the last two lines now. Mohushcho pitam So mohushcho pitam, that on his beautiful face there are the signs of Mother Yashoda having kissed him, and bimba raktadharam me, his lips are also like bimba fruits, very attractive, very beautiful. So that Lord, I want to remember. Alam lakshalavai, nothing else matters to me. So that same Krishna, whom Yashoda Mai has just a short while ago, she has, that very morning when Krishna was drinking milk from her breast and was drinking milk, she kissed him. But that same Krishna now is being tired. So now, what is with that same Krishna? What kind of person is he? So I was talking about how Krishna himself relishes and enables others to relish the full gamut of relationships, or all the flavors within relationships. So in every relationship, say if a child, we want our children to be obedient. And especially if they're disobedient, it's often quite disappointing, it's hurtful. But suppose somebody told us, okay, you know, we have artificial intelligence advancing now. So with technology, we will replace your child with a robot who will be 100% obedient to you. Who would want that?
Yeah, sometimes if the children are very disruptive and disobedient, we may want it sometime.
But after some time, it's like in every relationship, then the relationship remains, it has some juice, some spice in it when there is a healthy blend of predictability and unpredictability. In every relationship, and then there has to be some predictability for stability. Now, you know, if I do like this, okay, this person, if I tell this person to do like this, they're going to do this. Then some reliability, there's some steadiness, some stability comes. So predictability is required. But then there also has to be, for the relationship to be fresh and vibrant, there's some unpredictability. If suppose we tell something and then the person does something unexpected. Oh, okay, you think like this. Yeah, if a person is entirely predictable, then we feel like I'm interacting with a machine. If I say this, if I do this, they will do this. If I do that, if I say this, they will do that. If a person is entirely predictable, it's okay. We can say that person is steady, but then we might be too polite to say, but the person becomes boring. Isn't it? So we need a healthy blend in any, for any relationship to be alive. It's a healthy blend of predictability and unpredictability. So if your child is replaced with a robot, then it's only predictability, no unpredictability. So parents want children to be obedient, but there's also their own sweetness, their own individuality, that's also to come out. So now what Krishna does over here is, Krishna, when he performs mischief, so Krishna acts in the most endearing ways at times, and Krishna acts sometimes in the most infuriating ways. So in that way, there is a rich flavor of variety of mellows in the relationship. So that same Krishna who has been right now tied up, Sthita Graivam Damodaram Bhakti Vattam, it was said earlier. Same Krishna who has been tied by Mother Yashoda, now, he was just sometime earlier kissed by her. So this indicates that the spiritual relationships are not, they are all encompassing, they are inclusive. When a devotee wants to love the Lord, the Bhakti tradition actually describes both at a spiritual level as well as at a practical level, that it's sensory spirituality. There are some traditions which hold that to focus on spiritual, you have to give up everything sensual. This whole world is a world of illusion and maya. Give it up and turn toward God. But bhakti is sensory spirituality. Sensory means we use our senses. We use our eyes to behold the beautiful form of the Lord. We use our ears to hear about Him. Vani gunanu kathane shravanam kathayam hastau cha karmasu. So this will come in the next verse after this, that the Nalakura Manikuru are delivered. They say that now we want to, with our words, with our vani, with our voice, we want to speak your glories. With our ears, we want to hear your glories. With our hands, we want to serve you. So this is, so the bhakti is inclusive spirituality. Inclusive means, it's not that this is maya and rejected. All our resources, they are used to serve Krishna. And there are natural ways in which affection is expressed. So this is in the sadhaka stage also, we see that we use our senses. We come to the temple and we behold the beautiful form of the Lord. We hear this sweet kirtan of the Lord. And this applies also at the transcendental level. At the transcendental level, in fact, there are no worldly temptations. But the body itself, so that is, we usually think of the body in terms of physical body. But there can be spiritual body also. And that is pure, that is transcendental, non-material. And bhakti involves expressing one's love for the Lord through all of one's faculties, all of one's resources. So in the parental relationship, there is a natural expression of affection, especially say between the mother and a child, that especially an infant or a small child, the mother expresses the affection for the child by kissing. So here, when he's meditating, Rakta, the bimba, what is it? Muhushchumbitam bimba rakta dharamme. So Mother Yashoda has actually kissed. So this is describing how rich and how sweet the spiritual reality is. That in the spiritual world, all the aspects of our being are offered to Krishna, are connected with Krishna. And Krishna gives the devotee a body, a mind, and a soul. And of course, we are the souls, but everything is offered to Krishna. Now, this has several implications. That some people say that, oh, you know, you will go to the kingdom of God. What will you do over there? You look at God and God looks at you. And what else happened? You become boring after something. Actually, even if we had to look at God all for all of eternity, it won't become boring because Krishna is unlimitedly attractive. And Krishna can keep revealing his attractiveness more and more and more. And thus the devotee can behold the Lord eternally also. But that's not all that the relationship with the spiritual world are about. There are various ways in which a devotee can serve Krishna. And what generally engagement at the sensory level entangles in the world. But if the sensory activities are done for Krishna, they elevate us. And in the spiritual world, when the sensory activities are done for Krishna, they actually connect us more and more with Him. So the idea is bhakti spirituality is inclusive. So, Krishna's beauty is described many times in many places, and many of the descriptions are similar. But the striking part of this vision is this symbol that Yashoda Maya's kiss. And in this way, there are two distinct aspects I am talking about. One is that every resource that we have is included in our relationship with Krishna. And secondly, there are various flavors in that relationship. So when a devotee is with Krishna in the Chaitanya Charanamrita, which is a very advanced book of bhakti, of love for Krishna, it is described over there that a devotee experiences emotions like there are like an ocean. In an ocean, there are waves. And sometimes the waves can be stormy. Or sometimes the devotee experiences such ecstasy. It is described as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who was actually Radharani. Radharani descended in this world in the form of Krishna in the mode of it was Krishna manifesting love of Radharani. So you would feel great separation. And sometimes it is described that Krishna, that Lord Chaitanya, when he was singing the holy names, his arms would become extremely long. It would become super elongated. And sometimes they become completely withdrawn. They become completely withdrawn and drawn into the body, and it's like it's just a torso, no limbs at all. So, what was the significance of these physical contractions or physical transformations? So, it's described that sometimes the devotee feels Krishna is very close to me, and sometimes the devotee feels Krishna is very far away from me. And now, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would feel that Krishna is far away from me, his hands would stretch out, Krishna, please don't go away, I want to catch him. And his hands would become elongated. And when he would experience the presence of Krishna very closely, then at that time, his whole body would become withdrawn. Just like if we are watching some very fascinating movie or fascinating sports match or something like that, then people say, I don't even want to move my hands. I don't want any distraction. So people sit like a statue, watching. So this is what happens to Krishna when he manifests in the form of Jagannath. His limbs withdraw. Because if the limbs are present, they may be distracted. So just withdraw everything. So there is of course a withdrawal in the sense of becoming inactive, but there is a physical withdrawal also can happen. So the point is, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he feels the presence of Krishna, he doesn't want to feel anything else. And thus, all his limbs withdraw into himself. So the point again is that bhakti includes all our resources. It's a spiritual connection with Krishna, but it's also at the level of the body. And Mother Yashoda feels, now it's when she kisses Krishna, why is she kissing? It is because at one level, she wants to express her affection for Krishna. But at another level, it's also that she wants Krishna to feel her affection for him. Generally, in any relationship, there are two aspects. We need to have the emotion in our heart, the concern, the care, the affection. But also, the other person should also feel that. So, now in bhakti, when we express our emotion, when we practice bhakti, so what is the purpose? Some people say that, you know, why do you need to pray to God? God knows everything. He also knows what you need. So, why pray to Him at all? Now, and why chant His name also? You know, He knows His name. And He knows your heart. So what is the need to chant? So actually there are two distinct aspects over here. One is, in a personal relationship, the love may be there, but love needs to be expressed in a way that it is felt. It needs to be felt. So otherwise, two people, they might care for each other, but they are caring in different ways. Say, if you give me something very valuable and you are expecting for me to pay you in dollars, but if I pay you in Indian rupees and you never heard of Indian rupees, and it's just paper, and I give you something valuable and you're giving me nothing in return, and I said, I give you so much in return, you don't appreciate it at all. So what's happening? The two people are trading, but in different currencies. And then the relationship, the reciprocation is not fulfilling at that time. So similarly, sometimes we may do a lot for a person, but if they are expecting us to do something in a different currency, that means a father may work very hard so that maybe they can buy the most expensive, the best toys or the best sports kit for the child. But the child, all the child wants is, I don't want an expensive bat, I want you to throw a ball and play with me. So, love needs to be expressed in a way that is actually felt by the other person. So, in a relationship, love needs to be expressed. So, similarly for us with Krishna, we need to express our love. It's in the heart, but the whole point of a personal relationship is the reciprocation. See, in the spiritual world, Krishna knows everything. So, you could say Krishna knows when he's running away from Mother Yashoda. I'm running, Krishna, Mother Yashoda. Here I go, I'll slip and I'll escape. But there, when I go there, I'll be caught. So when we talk about Krishna Leela, the whole purpose is not simply the purpose of the action. It's like suppose something like a suspense movie is there. And then the whole thrill in most of the thrill in the movie is like who did the crime? And if somebody tells you, you know who did the crime? Don't tell me. I want to watch the movie myself. So if you know the end, then you feel that the whole fun is lost. That's why sometimes in movie reviews they write spoiler alert. This is the word they use also, spoiler. It spoils your fun. But suppose sometimes some movies or some serials or some stories, they have deep, rich emotions in them. And then people read them again and again. Not because they don't know the story, but they want to appreciate different aspects of it. Specifically in Krishna Leela, the point is not that Krishna is in our heart and He knows our love. The point is the reciprocation so that the relationship becomes deeper. And that's why we need to express our love. So I'm talking this in terms of when Mother Yashoda is kissing Krishna. The kissing is for two purposes. One is she wants that Krishna should feel love in her maternal relationship. And she also wants to express her love for Krishna. Both ways. So for us, when we are serving Krishna, we need to serve in such a way that we do the activities visibly so that Krishna can see. That's why the idea of bhakti is, it's in the heart, but it has to be expressed through actions. So yes, when we are chanting, when we are doing our sadhana, when we are doing seva, we are doing our puja, there is a lot of externals. But the externals are the way the internals are manifested. And they are expressed for Krishna. However, there is one more aspect to it. Like I said, Yashoda, so till now what I talked about, she loves Krishna, she kisses, so Krishna feels love. But she kisses because she also wants to express her love for Krishna. So similarly, devotion is not just when we do the activities of devotion, it is not just that Krishna, that love is expressed to Krishna, but it is that love is also experienced by us. The activities of devotion, they express they both express and they enable the expression and the experience of devotion. Because when we come in the temple and we fold our hands and when we pray, then if we do that, then we feel a little devotion. Say, for example, if I'm sitting here right now, if I lean back, put my hand like this, and then put my foot on this desk, and then I say, I'm feeling very humble now. It's almost impossible to feel humble. That posture itself is of either a bossy posture or at least like a very relaxed kind of posture. So our externals affect the internals. And when we act in particular ways, then it's not only that we are expressing, but we are also experiencing. So when we do the activities of devotion, they also enable us to experience devotion more. So Mother Yashoda is experiencing love for Krishna as she is kissing him. And similarly for us, when we do the activities of bhakti, we experience devotion. So sometimes people think of devotion simply as emotion. Oh, I want to feel some ecstasy. Well, and if they don't feel the ecstasy, then say, what is the point of doing this bhakti? I don't feel anything at all. But no, bhakti, Prabhupada translated as not just as devotion, but as devotional service. The idea is that devotional service means there is a devotion is the emotion that is internal, service is the action that is external. And both of them are there. And sometimes it may be inside out, sometimes it may be outside in. That means sometimes we feel our way to actions. We have certain feelings and then we do the actions. If we feel, oh, I want to go to the temple, I want to take darshan, I want to behold the Lord, I want to do the puja, I want to do the japa. But sometimes we act our way to feelings. We act our way. It's outside. We do the externals and gradually the internals will come. So this way, Mother Yashoda's kissing Krishna represents this deep dynamic of the expression and the experience of devotion that she is having in her transcendental relationship with the Lord. But while having that, there is also more going on. What is more going on? I'll conclude with this point and then you can have a few questions. That actually, Mother Yashoda, when she is expressing her love for Krishna, either it is by kissing him or by tying him. Now, kissing can be understood as a very, very self-evident, very obvious expression of love. Now, of course, some people, maybe in traditional culture, they may feel kissing. That's too explicit. Why talk about this? Some people are against the public display of affection, which is fine. But the point is, especially in the case of a mother and a child, it's a natural expression of affection. But in the other case, when she's tying up, so we could say that those people who are like very conservative, they may say, you know, why is, with respect to God and kissing, this seems to be like this is a bit too explicit. And some people who are too liberal. I was at one interfaith program and there was this person who said, you know, you people, you have this image where this child is tied up. He says, this is violence against children. In today's world, if a mother tied up a child, there will be court case against her. Not only a court case against her, child abuse, and the child would be taken away from the parent.
So those who are very liberal, they'll say, what is, she's an abusive mother. But the point is that disciplining is required. The liberal culture, in some ways, liberal is good, but it goes towards the extreme. One idea of liberalism is that all hierarchies are bad. So let everyone be equal. But it's not like that. Now, hierarchies are essential for functioning. If you go to a doctor and you're sick, you're having fever and you're feeling dizzy, then you ask the doctor, please give me some medicine and I'll get cured. And the doctor says to you that actually, you know, you have this symptom, this symptom, this symptom. These three symptoms can indicate this disease, this disease, this disease, this disease, or this disease. So there are five possible diseases. And for each of these diseases, you know, you can have this treatment, and you can have this treatment, you can have this treatment. So like that, the doctor says, there are 25 possible treatments. Which one do you want to take? When you go to a doctor, you know, we are a patient. We are not a shopper over there. Isn't it? So if a doctor starts treating the patient literally equally, it's not one to one. Doctor, you're expert, you have to tell. Of course, they should explain to the patient and they certainly say that the patient has to take decisions. But complete equality doesn't work, isn't it? So the liberal idea leads to total equality and that's bad. So now the specific ways in which parents may discipline children may vary according to culture to culture. And the point is that disciplining is essential. Those children who are not disciplined in their childhood, then what happens? They don't learn the necessary resources for growing in life. So basically, disciplining means what? A certain kind of action is to be done, certain kind of action is not to be done. And if that is arbitrary, that's bad. It can be abusive. But in life, certain actions lead to positive results. Certain action leads to negative results. And that capacity to discipline oneself is vital for success in any area of life. And parents have to develop the potential of their children. That's why discipline is required. So you could have both these expressions which can be objected to by different people. The kissing might be objected to by those who are conservative. The tying might be objected to by those who are liberal. But both are included in Yashoda Mai's expression of love for Krishna. So in the bhakti tradition, there will be people who are conservative, there are people who are liberal. If you look at our tradition, Nityanand Prabhu, Gaurnathai on the altar, Nityanand Prabhu is very liberal. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is quite conservative. And both of them are dancing together. So we have this dance of conservative and liberal also going on together. Again, the point is, Krishna bhakti is very inclusive. Love for Krishna can include kissing for Krishna. Love care for Krishna can include binding Krishna also. Similarly, there are many, many different ways in which love for Krishna can be expressed. And as devotees, the whole idea is each of us try to develop our individual relationship with Krishna. There are, of course, certain standard practices which are required for the development of the devotion. But eventually, each one of us has to have our individual offering is to be there to Krishna. We think Prabhupada would say that when you come to a temple, how do you know that you are Krishna conscious? Or how do you, not even when you come to a temple, how do you know you are Krishna conscious? Prabhupada gave different answers at different times, but in this particular talk, he says that when you come to a temple and when you bow in front of the Lord, and then you look, behold the Lord, and you feel the Lord is asking you, what are you doing for me? What are you doing for me? We have a personal relationship with Krishna. We are meant to offer something to Krishna. Krishna wants something from each one of us. Now, most people, when they come to the temple, they are asking God, what are you doing for me? No, I have this problem. I have made this prayer. I have done this. Why have not done it till now? So, the idea is, this is a complete inversion. So, asking from God, we are actually serving God. The whole world prays to God. The Brajavasis pray for God. Yashoda Mai prays for the safety of Krishna. Is there, now, does she think Krishna is God? She knows at the background Krishna is God. But at a functional level, no, Krishna is my child. I had to protect him. I had to discipline him. So even the idea of worship is included within the scope of serving Krishna. Vishuddha Mai, she thinks I will pray not to Krishna, but for Krishna.
Mm-hmm.
And thus, it's an endlessly rich relationship. And we all have that opportunity to enter into such an endlessly rich relationship with Krishna. Krishna, if you appreciate him, how extraordinary this conception of divinity is, how loving he is, and how this very extraordinary and loving Lord is present in our hearts, just so that we can offer our love to him, so that he can reciprocate love with us. Then that can attract our heart like nothing else to him. And then, as we start getting more and more attracted toward him, thinking about him will become more and more natural. So it's contemplation on the Lord will lead to attraction to the Lord. And attraction to the Lord will lead to greater contemplation on the Lord. And it becomes like a glorious cycle. So right now, we may have a little attraction and we may be doing a little contemplation on the Lord. So we may feel, I have no attraction, how can I do contemplation? No, whatever little attraction we have, with that we start contemplating on the Lord. If there is some pastime of Krishna you like, just try to meditate on that pastime again and again. If there is a particular darshan you like, keep a picture of that darshan in front of you, behold that. Particular kirtan, particular song you like, keep that. So wherever there is attraction right now, use that attraction to increase the contemplation. And by that contemplation, the attraction will increase. And when you have this attraction and contemplation both going on, then there will be spontaneous absorption. Right now we have conscientious absorption. We have to endeavor to focus on Krishna. And there is some effort required in conscientious absorption. But when there is spontaneous absorption, then it is effortless and it is joyful. And that is what we aspire for in our lives. So, Damodarashtakam reminds us of that. Legacy of love that awaits all of us. So, summarize what I spoke today. I spoke on this theme of how Krishna is an emanation of how we are all looking for a satisfying object of thought. And while we look for the satisfying object of thought, Krishna is the supremely satisfying object. We may have wealth, we may have our various things in the world, but people also, but sometimes satisfying, sometimes not satisfying. For our heart finds rest when it rests in Krishna. But when will it rest in Krishna? When we understand how attractive he is. And the Bhakti tradition reveals a radical conception of God, where God is not the father and parent, we are the child, but rather God has complete gamut of relationships. It's a radically different conception of divinity, where God becomes the child, the devotee becomes the parent. And God himself wants to relish the full gamut of relationships, and he wants his devotees to relish the full gamut of emotions within each relationship. So then he talks specifically in this verse of how Krishna wants his devotee to feel needed. And Yashoda feels, I have to discipline Krishna. I have to feel Krishna. I have to correct Krishna. So the thrust of this verse was on the principle of Yashoda Mai kissing Krishna. So I talked about how every relationship has, for it to be vibrant, is a combination of predictability and unpredictability. So Krishna is sweet and obedient, and that endears him to Mother Yashoda. And Krishna is mischievous and playful, and that also endears him to Yashoda. So here, Yashoda Mai kisses to express her love so that Krishna feels it, and to also, just out of her love, it's expression. So it's expression and experience both. So similarly, when we're practicing bhakti, it's Krishna can see our heart, but Krishna wants to see our actions. The whole purpose of Leela is the expression and reciprocation. So we do the activities of bhakti to express our love for him and also to experience deeper love by expressing it. And I concluded by talking about how in our relationship with Krishna, we include everything that we have, all aspects of our being. So if we see that I as a person am meant to make an offering to Krishna, Krishna waits in my heart for me to love him. We see that personal connect, then
we will take responsibility for our spiritual growth. And we taking responsibility means start with whatever attraction we have to do whatever contemplation we can. That contemplation will lead to further attraction. And then attraction and contemplation, as they move in a glorious cycle, will raise our devotion from conscientious absorption to spontaneous absorption. And then devotion will become effortless and joyful. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Is there any one question?
That there is some standard practices that we have to follow. Now, we see that a lot of people who are outside the bhakti tradition would not follow a regimented, I should use regimented, it's too strong a term, but the idea is that we follow like set, very set, definite practices for like what we call sadhana, to eliminate your consciousness. But some people will say, why do I have to do those? Why can I not just do it the way I want to do it? Like, okay, I will serve. It's not that I'm just saying that God is my heart. But I want to, you know, do something like, I want to offer food the way I want to. I don't want to say meal spread. I want to, do things my way, not like what is prescribed.
Okay, good question. So if somebody... If somebody wants to practice bhakti in their own way, I'll offer food the way I want, I'll sing the songs that I want, Krishna songs, whatever. So, how do you respond to that? See, there are multiple factors over here. It's like education. If I want to study a particular subject, okay, this is too humble now. Okay, it's fine. I think it's the last. So, I can always get a book and I can study, I can get any books I like and I can study a particular subject. If I want to say, study, somebody wants to study psychology, somebody wants to study a particular subject, they get books and they learn something. Now, if they want an authorized degree from a particular school, university, then they have to follow the pattern. And university sets. They have to follow the pattern which is given by their particular teacher. So there are two aspects to this. That similar applies when anime applies to devotion. Devotion needs to be valued, appreciated, and respected wherever it is manifested. But the sampradayas or the traditions, you could say broadly speaking, they are like universities. They offer us a structured way of nurturing our devotion. Now, is it possible that somebody can, you can have both possibilities, that somebody doesn't go to a university and still they become expert in something. It's possible. And somebody might go through a university for many times and still learn nothing else. Those exceptions are there. But the exceptions don't disprove the standard method. If we are sick and we need some medication. Now we will want to check with the doctor or has an authorized degree or not. Sometimes it might be somebody might be. They have a natural sense of medicine and they have a lot of experience. There can be people like that. And there can be some people with big degrees and still they are not good doctors. But generally the standard way is that we follow a particular process. So, can devotion be present even when somebody is not following structured ways of practicing bhakti? Yes, it's possible. It could be that it can be coming from previous life also. They might have done some bhakti and they're just carrying on from there in this life. And the whole idea is don't discourage people. In bhakti, there are two aspects. This is a very important concept. If you want to make sure that we we grow holistically, we grow wholesomely rather. That there is accepting people and expecting from people. So we do outline a standard trajectory, a standard pathway. And then we naturally, if we are trying to share bhakti practices, then there are certain expectations. But if somebody is not rising according to the expectations, then we don't have to make them feel guilty. We don't have to feel rejected. But yes, accept them where they are. So now, if this is the way you want to practice bhakti, fine. It's ultimately everybody has been given free will. And everybody can practice whatever way they want. Now, does that mean all practices of bhakti are equivalent? Not necessarily. So in some exceptional cases, somebody might not go to university, not and still learn a subject. So we generally need a guru, but it could be that somebody had some kind of guru in a previous life, and this life they are continuing on. And we need to, we cannot reduce bhakti down to bhakti is independent. It is swarat, like Krishna. So we can't reduce bhakti down to simply a set of protocols. By the same time, we cannot. Devotion is more than a set of rules, not less. That means it is not just ruleless, just effervescence of sentiment is not necessarily devotion. So if somebody, that is the way they want to practice, we accept that. And we try to connect with them at a human level, at a devotional level, but not necessarily pushing them. And maybe through the relationship, they start appreciating and then start growing after some time. But we don't, if somebody is doing a particular way of worship at their homes, that's their life, their choice. But if they say, this is how we want to do in the temple. No. Now, this is a particular, it's like somebody might be expert, even if somebody is expert in a particular field. But if there's a particular university, a particular way of teaching, this is the way of teaching. So we don't change the standard to pander to people. We teach the standard. But at the same time, we don't reject people because they're not following the standard. So to reject, this is a big subject. I talked about liberals and conservatives. So basically, what happens is I like a four-quadrant diagram I have, that there is generally concern for process and there is concern for people. Like suppose somebody is a surgeon. Then now they have to do surgery, they have to follow the proper process. But the purpose of the process is what? To heal the patient. Now, if a particular patient has some very unpredictable and complicated combination of ailments, you can't follow the standard process over there. And if you just simply follow the standard process, what will happen? Operation successful, patient dead. It'll be like that. So you could say that, you know, if people, there is concern for process, concern for people. There's no concern for process, no concern for people. They are like heartless, unsympathetic people. They don't help anyone. Those who have high concern for process and low concern for people. This is how things are to be done. Whether you feel like doing it or not, just do it. That's it. They are the conservatives. High concern for process, low concern for people. Liberals are those who have high concern for people and low concern for process. You can't do it this way, do it this way. And then the most effective people are those who have high concern for people and high concern for process. So now who is right? Are liberals right? Are conservatives right? It depends. Sometimes the process has to be stuck to no matter what you feel. But sometimes people have to be accommodated and the process has to be adjusted. So the integration of the process and the people of concern for people and concern for process, the integration is done by focus on purpose. Focus on the purpose. Say if a particular surgery is very painful, and now doctor says, oh, the surgery will cause a lot of pain to the patient, so I'll not do the surgery. And no, you have to do the surgery. So you have to have concern for the process, and you have to do it at times. But suppose if a particular bitter medicine is there, and we know in advance that if I prescribe this medicine, this patient is not going to take this medicine.
because it's too bitter. Then what do you do? Then we can say, I prescribed the medicine, they didn't take it, that's their problem. Mm-hmm. Or maybe there's some other medicine which is not that potent, but it's not that bitter also. That may not be as effective. But at least the patient is taking something, isn't it? So there has to be concern for process and concern for people both. And both can be integrated when there is focus on purpose. So if you focus on the purpose, what is the purpose? Our purpose is not simply to get people to join an institution. Our purpose is not simply to get people to conform to the standards of an institution. Our purpose is to equip people to raise their consciousness. Raise their consciousness from worldly consciousness to a devotional consciousness. So now, if we understand where they are and then guide them accordingly. Sometimes for some people, standard process is what is to be emphasized. And for some people, no, certain they may have to give in their room of what they want to do. But we should see that my purpose in interacting with people is to encourage them to raise their consciousness. And Prabhupada, one of his more well-known followers was Peter Barwash. Peter Barwash was a tennis player, prominent tennis player. And what had happened before that, Prabhupada had met George Harrison. And what George Harrison, he was probably the most famous person among entertainers at that time in the world. And he became a devotee and openly started singing about Krishna in his concerts. And what happened was, it just backfired. Like, people came for the kind of musical concert that he was famous for and suddenly started chanting Hare Krishna. And he asked people to chant Hare Krishna. And people started booing him and people started mocking him. And he got terrible reviews. And he told Prabhupada once that, Prabhupada, for one person that I'm getting to Krishna, I feel I'm sending 100 people away from Krishna. Because in media started saying, you know, he has become a cultist now and he's lost his flair, lost his touch. So to get a sense of how this would be is that, suppose, say, there is maybe World Cup finals, India-Pakistan match. And say India's top player, maybe say Virat Kohli, has become a devotee. And then the cricket match is over and India loses very badly. And there's a post-match interview. And then Virat Kohli says, hey, win, loss doesn't matter, just chant Hare Krishna. You cannot imagine anything that can do worse anti-preaching than that. Isn't it? You know, if you are in a particular profession, you are expected to deliver in that profession. And if you want to give something extra, you give extra. If you are a preacher in a temple, then speak about Krishna. If you're a cricketer, you have to perform in cricket. So what happened was that then George Harrison told Prabhupada, then Prabhupada said, okay, then use your intelligence, he said. You sing some normal songs and in between, sing some devotional songs. So balance it up. So with respect to Peter Barwash, now he had also seen this. So Prabhupada told Peter Barwash that you just raise people's consciousness by getting people at least to the level of vegetarianism. So he's written books on self-help and motivation. And by that, he's brought people to at least just accepting they raise their consciousness, practice some meditation, some chanting, come to vegetarianism. So we need to accept people. We need to see ourselves as resources for raising people's consciousness. And sometimes they can do it in a structured way. Sometimes they may do it in a less structured way. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Well, thank you.